This week we're in Shrewsbury for a lorry, but not any old petrol or diesel affair. No, nothing modern or anything like that.
The beauty we're planning to restore is powered by coal. It's a steam lorry.
A 100 years ago, if you'd been in the market for a heavy goods vehicle, you wouldn't only have been scratching your head thinking, do I buy a Volvo or a Merc? You'd have been saying, is it the internal combustion engine for me, or should I go for an electric lorry or good old steam? If you'd opted for steam, then you'd probably have gone for one of these. A Sentinel steam lorry, the Rolls-Royce of the puffing world. Capable of lugging over 15 tons at speeds of up to 40 miles an hour, the Sentinel was such a good vehicle, they were still making them in the 1950s. And the unlikely steam enthusiasts, who now want us to bring one back to life, are these two young whippersnappers, Edward and Andrew Goddard. Two good-looking young boys from Shrewsbury falling in love with a steam lorry is not as unhealthy as you may think. Sentinels made up the pulling power of the family firm for two generations, Morris's Lubricants. And if the boys want to run the firm in the future, then there better be a working steam lorry in the yard.
Our adventure starts here at an oil factory.
Very slippery business, Claire.
That's why I got your loafers on, eh?
These, Claire, are industrial steel toe cap loafers.
Right, right.
And you must be the Goddard brothers.
Yeah,
pleased
to meet you.
Hey,
you alright?
I'm gonna have a look at the job if you don't mind.
Well, here it is. Here, there, and everywhere, in fact. In bits, with the cab missing, it's difficult to imagine it once looked like this. The actual steam engine that moves the Sentinel is under the chassis behind the cab. It drives the rear wheels via a chain. At first inspection, all of that looks in pretty good nick. But the key to the Sentinel's power was its boiler. It's up in the front where the engine would be on a modern truck.
Well, there's a big hole here. This is where the boiler should be. I think there's plenty of woodwork to be getting on with as well.
Quite a mess, isn't it?
It is, but we had a problem with the boiler earlier in the year, and we got a little bit carried away, as you can tell. So we tidied it up for you, though.
I'd hate to have seen it before it was tidied. Well, I must say, I can look at these bits all day. They mean nothing to me. We'll leave Claire to have a proper look. And why don't you come and explain to me what this is all about?
Okay.
Well, the Goddard boys looked like they knew what they were doing when they took it apart, but let's hope we can put it back together.
So back in the 20s and 30s, the company used to have four Sentinel steam wagons, and they used to drive them in through here and then unload them here.
Must have been quite a sight, four of those steaming beasts in here.
Yeah, this used to all be cobbled right up the yard here, and they used to back the wagons in, and it used to be covered in oil, and they used to be able to slide the big wagons across by hand. They must have got a few blokes behind it, and...
No health and safety in the 1930s,
not a lot, I
don't think,
no.
So.
I think things have moved on since then.
Like any thrusting firm, the Goddards sold off their Sentinels in the late 1940s in favour of the modern diesel. But they're a traditional bunch up in Shrewsbury, and 30 years later, nostalgia got the better of them. Out came the chequebook, and Morris Oils owned a Sentinel once more. But at 72 years old, this grand old lady's heart is giving out.
Well, all this stuff looks a mess, but don't worry about it. The boiler, though, that's the problem.
It might look like a rusty barrel, but this thing was the steam world's equivalent of Concorde, a steam plant so efficient that it held out against the internal combustion engine for almost 50 years. But just like Concorde, the Sentinel's boiler is a thing of the past. So to rebuild one, we're going to have to start from scratch.
How's it looking?
Well, this bit's looking particularly rough, but never mind.
This, I presume, is the heartbeat of the entire machine,
yes,
the boiler.
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, so you're learning.
I am. I'm an expert, as you know. Even my cursory knowledge could tell you that that's pretty knackered.
As you so rightly know, they don't make them anymore.
Because I'm an expert, aren't I,
Because you're an expert, yeah.
That's right.
So, I've got a guy in mind, though, Andy Melrose.
He is the king of steam. Even I know that.
There is only one man in the country who'd be crazy enough to take on a task like this. Andy Melrose, the man we call the King of Steam. Andy's taken on a whole bunch of salvage squad projects and breathed life into them all.
Job's a good one.
But this one's different. Almost no one has made a boiler like this in 60 years, and that includes Andy.
Right, no promises, gentlemen, but let me ring Andy and see what we can do.
But the deal would be you won't be able to see it until it's done.
I trust Claire, Suggs.
So do I.
No trust in me, then. Oh, well.
And I trust Andy Melrose.
It seems the only thing the others will trust me not to mess up is the detective work. So my quest this week will be to track down the history behind our lorry and find out exactly how the Sentinel steam wagon, so advanced for its time, eventually became extinct.
Meanwhile, it's down to Andy's Somerset workshop, while the rest of the repairs are put on the back burner.
It looks a bit rough, doesn't it?
It does look rough.
Because if Andy can't fix the boiler, this restoration will be over and all the other work will be futile.
So have we finally met our match with this puffing juggernaut? This boiler's not only complex, it was designed to be made by machines in a big factory, not knocked out by hand in a shed. What? But if we can't find a way of doing the job, this old Sentinel will never puff again. This week on Salvage Squad, we're attempting to finish the restoration of a 1930s Sentinel steam lorry for these two young fuddy-duddies, Andrew and Edward Goddard. And I must admit, I'm rather concerned about what's happening to the youth of today.
What is it about these young boys and steam? I mean, what happened to record players and guitars and birds?
But then I'm just a city boy, which is why the lads have invited me out into the country to try and turn me on to ladies who chuff.
Meanwhile, me and Andy are getting our Sentinel steam boiler ready for the operating theatre. Although not much bigger than a domestic hot water tank, this is one powerful bit of kit. It consists of an outer pressure jacket and an inner firebox. The whole firebox is surrounded by water and dozens of tubes pass the water through the firebox itself. Once the heat gets going, this boiler is incredibly efficient, kicking out steam at 250 pounds per square inch to power her twin-cylinder, double-acting engine.
Bit different than moving a locomotive boiler about, isn't it?
It's so small. Does it have the same sort of power?
It was amazing how effective they were at generating steam.
Yeah.
I mean,
it is very small compared to our big traction engines and all the rest.
I mean, you think what we're looking at there is a fire area.
Yeah. It's tiny, isn't it?
The heating area is just what we see there.
Yeah.
Compared with a similar locomotive boiler, very small but very effective.
The problem we have is that Sentinel's boilers were made by machines long gone. If we have to start remaking the outer jacket or the firebox with their complex curves, then we're going to be in for a rough ride. But at the moment, we can't even get the two apart.
It's harder than it looks.
Now is the moment of truth. It's the first time we can look inside the boiler to find out just how bad it is and how much we're going to have to replace.
Well, it hasn't fallen apart quite like I hoped, but...
No, but...
It's not doing bad.
I think it's well on the way, don't you?
Oh! Finally.
And that was it.
Right, shall we get it out, then?
Yep, thank goodness for that.
After half a day's struggle, the thing finally comes apart. And it ain't looking good.
We need to clean off some sample areas to get a look. I mean, this doesn't look too encouraging here, does it?
Where's the vulnerable areas, then?
Well, that's the worst one, down round there.
Up right round the flange, corner. Yeah?
It's at the bottom, of course, when the cord is the right way up. And this area here, I'm a bit worried about because this does look quite heavy, this pitting.
Yeah.
And the amount of scale on it. But what we're really concerned about at the moment is thickness.
Look at all the crap in the bottom.
Yeah, so yeah.
That was a technical term there.
Corrosion has already eaten into the outer jacket. But if the firebox turns out to be as badly damaged, we're in serious trouble. Only Andy will be able to make that call. But first, I've got to clean the lime scale off so that he can take a closer look. Fingers crossed.
Whilst Claire and Andy assess the scale of the task, I'm about to get close up and personal with two young men and a steamy lady. Edward and Andrew have invited me to come and fondle their second favourite girl, a 1902 Burrell traction engine.
All right there, chaps.
Right, Simon, how are you?
How are you,
Very well indeed. Come down here. I'm starting to feel like a peasant talking to the landed gentry. Tell me, young chaps of your age, shouldn't it be like motorbikes and sports cars?
No, we don't like to move quite that fast in Shropshire.
It only goes about 4 or 5 miles an hour, really, and it's got a water tank at the back end, which only lets you go about 7 miles to a tank full. We prefer the Sentinel, really, for going greater distances.
The Burrell is a biplane compared to our Concorde of a Sentinel. The thing's all boiler, piston and flywheel. Mind you, it is kind of fun.
3-point turn. See if I pass my test first time.
Keep winding, keep winding. Keep
winding. Help, help, I'm becoming an enthusiast.
Concentrate, yes,
so I'm concentrating, not going into that ditch. Yeah. This is a bit worrying, I'm getting into this.
Feel the power.
Crushing my car with a steam engine.
Keep on
trying to get into this.
You wait until you get to the Sentinel. You almost had a nasty moment then.
So busy shouting and making jokes, really did nearly take a hedge out there. There's a lot of them about, eh? Well, fellas, you got me worryingly close to feeling like I was an enthusiast up there. You were safe.
I was speechless.
If a Burrell can be so much fun at 4 miles an hour, a Sentinel at 40 is going to be a gas. So long as Claire and Andy don't find too many nasties with the boiler.
What about the firebox, Andy? Can we use it?
Yes, it'll do. It's not great, but it'll do a couple of years. That's really no problem.
Mm-hmm. What about the outer shell, though?
Yes, this is a different matter. This has really absolutely had it. It needs a new one. It can't be repaired. The amount of wastage is...
So wasted
really
and pitted. There's not a lot of metal left in places.
Absolutely, no.
So, if we can't repair it, we're going to have to make a new one.
Exactly, yes.
Are you feeling nervous about it or confident?
Oh, you always got to be confident, haven't you? Never being nervous.
We'll see it as a challenge, shall we?
It's got definitely a challenge. That's right, it's definitely going to be a challenge.
Things could have been worse. We're only going to have to remake the outer jacket. But we've got no plans to go on. Hence my promotion from engine driver to detective and my appointment at the Shropshire Record and Research Centre, home of the Sentinel Archive. Hopefully I'll be able to track down some old blueprints to help the workers down in Somerset.
Well, I've been given quite a few of these acetates of the various bits, components of the Sentinel steam wagons, but it's kind of pot luck as to whether I'm actually going to find anything that's of any use to Andy and Claire.
Luckily, archives expert Andrew Davidson has been doing some digging on my behalf and has found some full-size plans that might do the trick.
Well, we've got just a few plans that would have been about the original size of the drawn plans, but very few, and you can see what you make of them.
The rear drawbar support pressing, I'm sure it's great interest to somebody out there, but not to me. Hold on, this looks quite interesting. The Sentinel patent water tube boiler. This could be exactly what Andrew Melrose is looking for, yeah.
They might not look much, but those drawings are going to put a few smiles and some faces back at the workshop. They're the last surviving plans of a boiler so efficient that it kept the Sentinels going until the 1950s. Thousands of Sentinels were built here, and the archive holds photos of hundreds of them.
There's some great pictures here of the brand new Sentinels coming out of what I presume are the factory gates.
That's right.
And is this factory still around?
Yes, you can go and see that.
Now, Andrew, you wouldn't know anybody else who might be able to help a little bit with the history of the Sentinel.
Well, there's one man in particular who could help you, and he wrote the book, basically, a man called Tony Thomas.
Fantastic.
I think you should chase him down.
I'll try and track him down, thanks.
Sadly, my quest for Tony Thomas is going to have to wait, as down in Somerset, there are two cold engineers awaiting some blueprints.
And like Superman, he arrives just at the right moment. I've got something here for you. But firstly, Andy, I'd like to say, looking around here, I'm not overly reassured that we're ever going to get our boiler done. What are you doing, collecting them?
No, don't worry. I mean, only a short queue. 10 years or so, no more.
Yeah. No, well, on a serious note, yes, I've been to the Shrewsbury Public Records Office, and I do believe I have the original dimensions. There you are.
We're bound to be right now.
Well, I also got a tip that there's a local historian, a Mr. Tony Thomas, who might be able to fill in a little bit of the background of the Sentinel, so I'm off to see him. Make sure that one goes to the front of the queue, Claire.
All right, cheerio.
See you, so.
Let's have a look.
Well, I'll have to put my tea down for this. This is important stuff. The most important measurement of all is the distance from that flange to the flange at the bottom. Now, that just happens to be where the drawing is a bit shaky.
No, hang on. Isn't it transferred on that side? There you go, it's on that side. You're looking on the wrong side, Andy. There it is.
You're right.
10 and a... Is that a quarter?
Maybe 10 and a quarter, I would think.
Right, chap.
Yeah.
I'll leave you to it. I'll see you later, all right?
Yeah. See you, Claire. Bye.
Bye. While Andy gets on with working out how we're going to make those curved flanges, I'm off to Deepdale Engineering in Birmingham to make the steel tube that will eventually turn into our outer jacket with the help of one Des Jones and a lot of beefy kit. To reconstruct the boiler, we'll need a completely new outer jacket for it. And believe it or not, this will be constructed from a single sheet of metal. This one, in fact. The first job is to slowly roll it into a cylinder, keeping our fingers crossed that when the two edges finally meet up, they'll be perfectly lined up. And that's only going to happen if we put it into the rollers perfectly straight in the first place.
Does that look all right?
Beautiful.
You sure?
Perfect.
Says it's square?
Yeah.
And if you're thinking that checking it by eye doesn't seem very accurate, it is if you've been doing it for 20 years. One tweak and Des reckons it's perfect.
I bet I won't find that in any tool catalogue anyway, will I?
In preparation for the final weld, I just need to burn off excess dirt and dust, which may have lodged in the seam. And now, the moment of truth. The cylinder must meet our specifications exactly, otherwise it won't fit round the firebox. So it's out with the tape to measure the circumference of each end.
One mil and 2 mil on serve, which is not the mil on diver, that perfect point.
Now that doesn't mean very much to me, but the perfect pipe did. Understand that?
Next, the boiler has to be welded. To make a strong permanent bond, a high-tech laser-guided machine is used. This contraption creates a weld as thick and strong as the metal around it. With a perfect weld down the seam, we have the beginnings of our outer jacket, but that's the easy work done. They turn out dozens of tubes like this every day. What we're going to do next has hardly been done for 60 years. The plan is to bend the ends of the cylinder inwards to form two flanges into which the firebox will be bolted. On paper, it's simple. Put a former inside, apply heat, and push the metal hard against the former. Voila! Job's a good'un. Key to the process is this monster, a massive hydraulic press capable of pushing down with a force of 200 tons. The military used to use it for all sorts of hush-hush things that were built to go bang in some way, but now we've got to adapt it to build a Sentinel boiler that won't go bang in any way. The first part of the job is to drop in the former. This is the mould for the flange. Then we'll put the whole lot under the massive press and we're ready to go. That's the theory. Sounds good, eh? But neither Andy or I really know if it's going to work. So the heat is on.
It's not going to be easy making the outer racket for the boiler. You start off with a very simple steel tube, The hard bit is making the flanges at either end. You've got to bend the metal round, and as soon as you do that, you end up with creases. You're going to have to lose that material somewhere. It's not going to be an easy job.
Getting all scientific about it, what we're trying to do is to get the metal so soft we can mould it, just like a potter shapes clay. We'll actually end up with the metal around the flange being round an eighth of an inch thicker than the rest of the boiler. The key is to make sure we don't get any creases, as they'll be almost impossible to get out.
We're putting so much heat into the job, it's unbelievable. You cannot begin to imagine how hot it is in this corner of the workshop. But when you put the press on it, it just falls like butter.
After 4 hours of inching the metal into shape, bit by bit, constantly adjusting the heat and pressure, disaster strikes. Suddenly, a crease appears.
Pushed it too hard, see? Pushed it too hard in one place. Yeah, just too much hard.
Too enthusiastic?
Yeah. I mean, at the end of the day, we weren't putting much more pressure on than we had done before, but it was just that at that moment it was too much, you know?
Now it's creased, it's going to be virtually impossible to stop it creasing again. After all the long hours we've spent getting this far, one tiny push too much, and now the whole lot could be scrap. The big question is, can we save it?
The big decision, that is. I don't know. We'll see.
This week's Puffing Beauty, a 1931 Sentinel DG4, is a love of two thrusting lads, Edward and Andrew Goddard. Love steam as I do, I'm more likely to end up going for Mr. September, as my attempts at rebuilding their Sentinel boiler are not going too well. We're actually trying to do the impossible here, put a smooth flange in the end of a tube. And as is the way with the impossible, it's not working. After 4 hours of gentle coaxing into shape, a crease has suddenly appeared in the flange. At this moment, no one knows if we're going to be able to coax it back out again. And if we can't, this whole lot's heading for the scrap heap.
Yeah, that's where it started to corrugate. Here, it's corrugated. The rest of it's fine. But we want to try to fix this first.
With things not going too well in Somerset, I'm heading to meet a chap who, I hope, is going to be able to tell me a bit more about our Sentinel's history.
Well, I've come here to Shrewsbury, to the site of the original Sentinel factory, which was moved here from Glasgow in 1915. And I wonder, is there any of it left?
The Sentinel production line was as advanced as any making diesel trucks at the time. And you can see the scale of things from the building still standing. But somewhere around here should be author and Sentinel enthusiast Tony Thomas. Hopefully he can tell me why the Sentinel, so advanced for its time, finally ran out of steam.
You must be Tony.
Hello.
How do you do? Is there any chance you could show us around?
Oh, certainly. Yeah.
Great.
If anyone can fill in the blanks of the history of our Sentinel, it's Tony.
So, Tony, here we are, what's left of the old Sentinel factory.
Yes, well, these are the buildings in which they were built. During the manufacturing from 1915 to 1938, they made 6,500 steam wagons at this factory.
And what's brought about the demise of these fabulous vehicles?
It was an uphill battle against the diesels and the petrol lorries. That was one of the things that led to the demise, was the fact that it could take you over an hour just to raise steam before you could move.
To us, it's obvious that diesel is better than steam. But back then, diesel was a bit newfangled, while steam was well understood. But what about our Sentinel, number 8571?
Well, 8571 was built in August 1931 for Samuel Banner of Bootle. I've got a photograph of it here.
Fantastic. And this is our lorry.
Many of them were, in fact, taken in the lay-by across the road here with a Sentinel housing that they built for their employees in the background. Well, they had it for 3 years. Then it was sold to Paul Brothers of Liverpool, who were millers. And they had it until 1949. Then it was rescued from the scrapman by Edgar Schoen. Edgar Schoen had it restored. This is it in 1916.
50 years ago, Edgar Schoen would have been considered a crank, a nutter who insisted on paying good money for scrap. But now he's a bit of a hero, and he's certainly the reason our Sentinel is still with us, even if it can't chuff.
If anything, we have got a bit too much heat. This is a little bit much. It's got to be red,
yeah.
But
not cherry
but
red.
Not bright red, not orange red, just sort of a...
Yeah.
Yeah, a cherry red, really. Yeah.
After another 5 hours nudging cherry red metal into shape, we have the flanges completed. They may not look much, but just try making them on the end of a toilet roll and you'll see how hard it is. With Andy admiring his handiwork, my next stop is Hollyoaks Coach Builders to repair the cab with Bob Brown. It's the only other big job, as Edward and Andrew already had the chassis and running gear repaired.
Hi, Claire.
How's
Hiya.
It going?
Oh, we're going to have to start from scratch. It's had it.
Andy was pulling those faces down in Somerset
yeah,
with the boiler.
No, it's past it. We're going to have to rebuild the clamp as new, as it was originally, start from scratch.
It's looking very sad.
Yeah, it has. It's had it. It's had it, unfortunately.
It's odd. I don't feel too bad hacking off bits of rusted metal, but carting off that rotten cab didn't feel right somehow. But soon, there'll be a new one in its place.
There's a big plate under here. That's it. Right. Okay.
The cab is mainly made of wood, with a steel apron around the front of the boiler, and three metal posts holding up a plankton tarred roof.
26 and a half.
The first problem is going to be finding some quality wood to rebuild the main frame.
Got a piece of mahogany which I think will do the job.
Yeah? You sure there's enough?
Oh yeah, there's enough. As you can see, from that end to that end, about 24 foot.
That is a monster of a plank, just being used as a bit of flooring.
That's been there for 30 years.
So it's well and truly seasoned,
well
then.
And truly seasoned.
Right. Should we get it out of here and machine it?
Yep, we'll do that.
The original Sentinels would have used good old British ash. But heck, we're getting this foreign stuff for free.
But I've got no plans.
Got no measured drawings.
No measured drawings or nothing.
So we're copying the original.
That's it. We're going to copy this piece here, do some measurements, and then we'll machine it out.
All this woodwork takes far longer than you'd expect. I'm going to leave Bob to get on with it and head back to Somerset.
Whilst I've been away, Andy's been at it with the drill, making 100 holes in the flanges of the jacket, which we hope will line up perfectly with the holes in the old firebox.
But we won't really know if it all lines up until we put the firebox inside and try and bolt it all together.
Right, Claire, let's just drop this down over here.
So I'll paint you an improved lifting device.
Well, this makes it a bit easy to lift it because it's hard to sling it square without something actually gripped on it. So tighten the band on there. You don't particularly want it dropping off halfway.
There's 50 holes on the top of this boiler and 50 on the bottom. If Andy's drilled just one of them in the wrong position, then this lot's not going to go together, and all that wonder work on the flange will be for nothing.
At this stage, I can't remember what stud goes where.
Well,
never mind.
You're learning, Andy. You I mean, you've not been in this game for very long.
Right. That goes there.
Right.
Second time lucky.
OK. Back there again, Leigh. Up again, Leigh. Down.
We've got 50 holes on the outer wrapper, we've got 50 holes on the firebox, and we've got to get them all lined up. Let's face it, it was never going to work first time.
Nope. Looks like it's in the wrong position again.
That one's there.
We've got to start again, really.
Well, should we block it up, then?
Yeah.
Third time lucky. This time, it looks like we're almost there. But it's still going to take some persuading. Fingers crossed.
Spot on. Who's stopping us?
There.
That's it.
typical. All that measuring and remeasuring, and all it needed in the end was brute force and ignorance.
Yeah. I know from the outside it probably doesn't look very much, but just think back. There's 200 holes here, all that measuring, the drawing, actually getting it to fit. It's a minor miracle of engineering.
With Andy celebrating the union of the two halves with a quick pint, I'm left on my own to tighten up the 100 bolts that will keep this boiler from blowing half of Shrewsbury into the next county. Next morning, I'm up with the larks and heading north again to Hollyoaks, the coach builders, to give our new cab a nice abrasive stroke. The last time I saw it, the cab frame was in bits, but Bob's been working hard, all those jigsaw pieces of mahogany are now in place.
Okay.
And although all that knuckle scraping sanding work goes against the grain, the results are worth all the hard graft. The rear of the cab is practically finished.
That looks really good, Bob.
That's somewhere near now. Yeah.
That mahogany across the top.
Yeah, that's ideal. Yeah.
Bit more to do there.
Yeah, a lot more to do, Claire. A lot more to do.
The next job on the list is making a new front apron. The old one looks okay at first glance, but the rust moths are beginning to eat it away at the bottom, so it may as well be done now.
It's starting to get up into the metal, so I think the best thing we can do is mark it out on a new panel, cut it out, and fit the new panel. And then we've got a brand new cab.
Without the plans to this part of the steam lorry, the old apron comes in useful as a template for the new one.
Oh, that's all right, Bob. We've got the rough shape cut out.
As Claire snips into the elegant curves of the Sentinel's cab, it feels like we're really getting the edge on this restoration. But there's a long way to go yet.
The cab's ready to assemble, so I've brought the Sentinel down to Andy's to fit the new boiler. Go on then, Andy. Head on down.
As we didn't take the boiler out, we don't really know how difficult it is to get back in.
We'll have it, give it one go, but I'm not very optimistic that it'll go. Lovely.
But with a jiggle and a poke or two, it fits like a glove.
Brilliant!
It's a tight fit, isn't it?
And now we can get on with plumbing everything up.
There. No, that's a plug. That's the top.
It's awkward.
That one.
Now we've got the boiler in, Bob and I can begin riveting on the rest of the body.
Okay.
Yep.
Nice and solid.
None of your modern pop rivets here. These are traditional copper rivets. Each one needing a head bashed onto it by hand. Yep. With all this love banged in, the cab should be good for another 70 years.
Hello, Claire.
Hello. How are you?
Very well.
This is Bob. He's in charge of the coachwork. This is Suggs. Suggs always turns up at the last minute. 29,051 rivets. Last four left. Go on, do you want to make yourself useful? You hold this.
What?
With hammer in hand, I'll show them what love is. It must be this.
Well, this is riveting, isn't it?
The rest of the bits of the cab have been pre-assembled. A bit like flat-pack furniture, except that they fit.
Okay.
It's looking good, isn't it?
Oh, it looks excellent.
I think my help has really made the difference. Look, half a day of Suggs' labour and she's almost done. But I must away on another quest, my search for her previous owner, Edgar Schoen, the man who saved our Sentinel.
With the Ego heading north, it's time to get out the spray gun and zap the cab. This may look like British Racing Green, but with a top speed of 40 miles per hour, that would be silly. So the livery we've chosen is the same as the Morris oil fleet had back in the 1930s.
Great, thanks very much. Well, I've been doing a bit of detective work on Edgar Schoen, the man who saved our sentinel from the scrap heap, and unfortunately he's passed away. But I have managed to track down his son, Jack. And I've heard that the sentinel's been painted and it's looking particularly beautiful at the moment, so I've arranged to meet him down there so he can have a sneak preview of our handiwork. So, Jack, here we are. How does that look to you?
A little different than the last time I saw it, certainly. Oh, considerably different.
When was the last time you saw it?
Probably in the early 70s.
Yeah.
Yeah, so it's 30 years ago. That's right.
With her new paintwork gleaming, she looks magnificent. A fitting tribute to the man who rescued her over 50 years ago.
Must have been taken shortly after he bought this engine.
Jack's father, Edgar Schoen, had worked with Sentinel steam lorries in his haulage business in the 1930s and jumped at the opportunity to buy a Sentinel when they were being scrapped after the war. He bought our Sentinel from Paul's Brothers Flour Mills in Birkenhead in 1949 and drove it home to his pub in North London, where he completely restored it and added it to his collection.
Everyone he used to tell me had its own characteristics. I mean, I couldn't tell you what they were, but there's no doubt about it. He knew when one drove down the road which one it was. In those days, nobody wanted them. Everybody thought he was mad. I thought he was mad. I was in the queuing for the cinema, and my father drove by, and I was with my friends, and I pretended I wasn't there.
So you weren't overly enamoured by them?
They were dirty, horrible, smelly things, I thought at the time. I was 12 years old.
Yeah.
Madly in love with sports cars.
Have a look in the cab.
I will.
Yeah.
Gosh, you could probably get in there and not get dirty, couldn't you?
You could now. I don't know about that.
Which is...
Can I have a look here?
Yeah.
Oh, gosh, you've got...
As a boy, Jack only had eyes for sports cars. But in later years, he has come to care more about the Sentinel that his father loved.
It's the emotions that I only really developed, I suppose, as I grew older, realizing what I'd missed when I was young. Not sharing his enthusiasm. And I suppose when you look back and your parents are gone anyway, you always think of the things you should have done. And things you should have helped with, and
yeah, I actually think that's quite universal. Yeah, but I suppose in this particular case,
well, it meant so much to him. He must have been one of the first collectors and restorers of these engines. I don't know if there's anyone before him, but he certainly was one of the first. And it makes him something special, doesn't it? But anyone that's he knew anyone that would talk to him about engines would, you know, would talk forever. Oh, gosh. Yeah.
Well, she certainly looks the part, but we'll have to wait until tomorrow to find out if she'll run under her own steam. It's crunch time for our Sentinel steam lorry restoration. We've replaced the cab and taken on the massive task of repairing her knackered boiler. But before we can go anywhere, it has to pass a rigorous inspection. If it fails, then all our hard work will have been in vain.
I'm up early to get steam up for the boiler test.
It's a very, very cold, frosty morning, and it's trying to snow out there. But I can think nothing better than setting fire to a steam engine.
Struggling with a lighter, a coal shovel, and an oily rag, I can see how people found diesels more convenient than Sentinels. But they're not half as much fun. As the snow starts to fall, the steam pressure rises, and the cab is the warmest place to be. All you can do is sit and wait and wait until it's full steam ahead.
How's it looking? It's behaving?
Yeah, 200 nearly, so won't be long.
We got much water?
Yes, water's all right. Better get a bit more coal on, I think.
One last shovelful of coal, and the pressure is approaching 250 pounds per square inch. She's as ready as she'll ever be. All we can do now is wait and hope that she passes the boiler test. We're at the mercy of the man from the ministry. Boiler inspector John Glaze checks that the boiler has no leaks and that the safety valve blows off when the pressure reaches 250 pounds per square inch. If the valve failed, the steam pressure would rise to dangerous levels.
Yeah, very good. Can we drop the ash pan now, please, so I can have a look around the foundation ring?
Yeah.
Finally, he checks the inside of the boiler with a mirror. Let's hope his verdict reflects our hard work.
Happy, John?
Yeah, very, very. Proper job. Lovely. I've got your report and certificate here.
Good. Lovely. Like pass it on to Claire. Yeah, everybody will be pleased, won't they?
Thank you very much.
You're now fit to be on the public highway.
That means we've passed.
Very good. Thank you for that, John.
It's a pleasure.
We can head off down the road.
We've passed the final test. Andrew and Edward are going to get their pride and joy back after all. It's a miracle! Sucks has finally made the tea.
Finally made himself useful.
Took me all morning. It's alive. It's living and it's breathing. I can almost feel its personality now, Claire. Shh, don't tell anyone. I think I'm becoming a steam buff. It's scary.
Go on, get polishing.
What?
Go on, you know how to do it.
Just call me Mr. Finishing Touches. It's all very well, all that heavy engineering stuff, but it's the detail where it counts. This unique and wonderful machine is ready to get back on the road, and Claire and I are finally getting our first ride in the beautifully restored number 8571, complete with 16 barrels of Morrison's oil on the back.
It's so quiet.
It works.
It is at the moment.
With the brasswork shining and Andy behind the wheel, we're off to meet a couple of excited boys back at the old Sentinel factory. I may have got in touch with my inner steam nut, but it's still not the most comfortable way to travel.
If you're going to get stuck behind a lorry, it might as well be a steam one.
This is the Sentinel Works. This is where she came from.
Over 70 years since it rolled off the production line, the Sentinel is back where it started and looking good as new.
As the Sentinel creeps in the back entrance, I join Andrew and Edward at the historic factory gates. With Andy in the driving seat and Suggs as master of ceremonies, it's left for me to take the boys by the hand and reunite them with their beloved Sentinel.
Yeah, I really am looking forward to seeing this. It's been a long time coming.
I don't think
I hope it's up to scratch.
Look at that.
Oh, my word. That is absolutely fantastic.
Yeah, it's looking really good, that is.
It looks really, really, really smart, doesn't it? It really does look smart. I've never seen it looking anything like that. That's absolutely marvellous.
Don't look at the fancy cladding, though, because underneath there is a brand new boiler.
Yeah.
And that was the hard bit. That was the real challenge.
And is it working all right?
It's like a dream.
We ought to go on a proper test, I think, and you should take it up the Horseshoe Pass to try it out.
Yeah, that'll give it a test.
Horseshoe Pass.
Horseshoe Pass, that sounds a bit ominous.
Horseshoe Pass in the middle of January is to be really good fun, and that'll be a severe test for it.
Horseshoe Pass in North Wales is a very steep winding road. Over its 2 mile length, it rises to 384 metres above sea level. The Sentinel factory sent every new steam lorry to be road tested on this challenging hill climb, which pushed the Sentinel to its limits. A Sentinel that made it to the top of Horseshoe Pass was ready for anything. But before we start the test, there's time for a group photo. Every single Sentinel that was ever built had its photograph taken in front of the factory, often with the workers who'd done all the hard graft. So we thought we'd continue the tradition.
Just as the Goddard boys get back on board, a heavy snowstorm starts. Horseshoe Pass is a tough test in normal weather, but will the 70-year-old 7-ton Sentinel make it up in these treacherous and icy conditions? As even modern four-wheel drives are being turned back.
It's going to be touch and go whether we can get anywhere at all. It will be a real trial by fire, or should I say ice. But we're not going to give up yet. We're determined to try. But as conditions worsen, we can barely see the road ahead.
Waiting nervously with Andy and I halfway up the hill is Jack Schoen, whose father saved this marvellous machine from the scrap heap.
I see they're turning some of the cars back up there, so I hope it's getting this far. Oh.
They're going to do very well to get much further, I think.
Get this far, it'll be a victory for us.
She'll never be able to make it up here in these conditions. But wait!
Yeah, I can hear something. Yeah. Definitely not a Peugeot 305. Yeah, here she comes!
I can't believe it! They've done it!
Oh, gosh, she's working out. Oh,
going well.
Beautiful. Come on, my baby.
Oh, God.
Very good. Well done.
Going quite well now, I would say.
Didn't think you'd get this far, to be perfectly honest.
Well,
it's going like a dream. Fantastic.
I just don't think we're going to get much further.
No.
Conditions are against us somewhat.
Very slightly.
Unfortunately, the dangerous ice means we can't get any further up the pass. But the Sentinel has performed brilliantly, and although they didn't get over the hill, Andrew and Edward are over the moon.
Hooray! 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 You're going to have every Sentinel owner in the country after you to fix their boilers now.
Not all at once, I hope.
Thank you very much, everybody.
The old girl has shown she's still got what it takes, and she's even turned me into a steam enthusiast. I hope she goes on for another 70 years.
It's the house that nobody wants, and estate agent Andrew Winter and city gardener Matt James try to do the impossible in a Selling Houses special tomorrow at 8. Next off, Although Secrets of the Dead reveals incredible new evidence about the Turin Shroud. And to find out more about the salvage squad, just press text on your remote and go to page 428.